We'll talk more, much more, of this matter of initiative if the Lord permits us further sessions together. But let us now approach the moment of commitment. I propose a prayer, which we will pray in unison, but with singleness of heart, as together we pledge ourselves to this experiment, to this demonstration, God helping us, of discipleship. Let this be no idle moment. Do not join us in the prayer of commitment unless, God helping you, you are willing to stake everything, your desires, ambitions, your security, your future, even your reputation if necessary. Any price God may ask, in order that the Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you through the Holy Spirit by faith. I will lead us, sentence by sentence, through a simple prayer of commitment. If it is your purpose to join in this commitment, repeat the prayer in unison after me. But don't pray. For your sake, don't do it unless you are sure this is what you want above anything else. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose love sent the Savior into the world.
Almighty God, whose love sent the Savior into the world.
Even as by faith I once received Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Even as by faith I once received Jesus Christ as my Savior.
Realizing I have no righteousness in myself on which I can depend.
Realizing I have no righteousness of myself on which I can depend.
So by faith I submit, and I commit my life to Jesus Christ as his true disciple.
So by faith I submit, and I commit my life to Jesus Christ as his true disciple.
This I do in complete dependence by faith upon the counsel of the Word of God.
This I do in complete dependence by faith upon the counsel of the Word of God.
And in dependence upon the power of the Holy Spirit within me.
And in dependence upon the power of the Holy Spirit within me.
To the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray.
To the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Congratulations. God bless you. And if perchance you were not ready to make this commitment, don't be discouraged. Go to the Word of God. Let it speak to you. If you've not made sure your relationship to Christ as Savior, I suggest you read the Gospel of John.
But Thomas, one of the 12, was not with him when Jesus came. So the rest of the disciples said to him, "We have seen the Master." "Unless I see the marks of the nails in his hands," Thomas exclaimed, "and can put my finger into the marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." Then Jesus said to Thomas, "Place your finger here and look at my hand, and place your hand here and put it into my side, and do not refuse to believe." And Thomas exclaimed, "My Lord and my God." A week later, the disciples were again at the house, and Thomas with them, and the doors had been shut. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you. It is because you have seen me that you have believed," said Jesus. Blessed are they who have not seen, yet have believed.
Rachel! I thought you had already gone to the auditions.
I'm not going to the auditions.
Not going? But I thought you said there were last night and tonight.
Oh, Mother, you wouldn't understand.
Not understand? Not understand what?
I've got so much to think about.
Well, darling, what's more important to think about than your future?
That's what I am thinking about. My future.
Then you just hustle yourself right down to the Civic, dear, and stop this silly nonsense.
Silly nonsense?
Rachel, darling, be sensible, dear. You really don't believe that people like, well, people like Ed Norman, you really don't believe that they're suddenly going to...
Mother, what Ed Norman does, what any of these other people at church do, I'm interested. But most of all, I'm interested in what I do. Life has got to add up for me, Mother. Can you understand that? Can you know what it means to a girl, and I don't want to seem ungrateful, to have had anything she wants, anything money can buy all her life, and yet be so hungry, so terribly hungry, just to know for sure that faith is real, that God is real. Oh, you don't understand. You don't want to understand.
That's out of our class, Spieler.
Live around here?
Yeah, we do.
You looking for somebody?
You ain't one of them new lady cops.
Our family owns some property around here, and...
You mean you're a landlord?
Whatever I am, I'm harmless. And friendly. You gals like to see some country?
A ride?
Why not?
Call me Jenny. Jenny Montana.
That's a pretty name.
You sure you ain't a cop? You ask a lot of questions. It don't matter. I've been clean ever since they sent my boyfriend up to the reformatory.
Your boyfriend?
Briggs Calhoun. He's crazy about cars. That's what he got sent up for. Cars. Maybe it don't seem like nothing to you, but guys that don't have cars, not even their folks, makes them crazy sometimes. We was together, Briggs and me, when he got caught in the car. They let me off with probation, but that's all run out now.
Attend church any place, Jenny?
Church? There's a mission some of us go to for kicks once in a while. If Briggs was in town, I wouldn't go.
Why?
I'd be scared to. Are you for real an actress, like you said?
Yes and no, Jenny. I'll tell you all about it sometime. Right now, there's a root beer stand coming up.
This shall be one of the greatest sources of our power, sharing what the Holy Spirit has done in our lives. Who's next?
A man can change. Any age. I'm learning that, Pastor. I've been real set in my ways. Though I've claimed to be a Christian for many years, I'm experiencing for the first time what it means to know Christ.
Charlie's right. A man can change at any age. He's got to change when the Spirit of Almighty God grips his heart. But like you warned us, Pastor, there's a price to it. There's a price to it. My business operates on close margins, very close. And for a week now, this past week, I've tried, with the help of God, to put Christian principles first. And I don't know. I really don't know if I can keep my business or not. But I'll tell you something. I'd rather go bankrupt. I'd rather walk the streets and beg, then lose for one moment this, I can't explain it, this peace of God in my heart.
I really don't know how to explain this, except that it's some sort of a miracle, my standing here before you. As you all know, I've considered myself to be a substantial churchman. But letting God have a corner of your life, and then, as he gives you the wisdom and strength to do it, letting him have every bit of your life, and suddenly you realize that you haven't really lived before.
I'm standing, not to give testimony, for as yet I have no testimony to give of having lived the Christian life. I want to give public witness that, as a result of having searched the Bible this past week, I have put my complete trust in Christ as my own personal redeemer.
My name's Jim Doan. Ed Norman suggested I slip by and talk to you. Got a beautiful spot here along the lake.
You're from the newspaper?
Well, you don't specialize much on a small newspaper. I've been handling the church page, but I also did that story on the Civic Theater last winter. We used you as our storyline, you may remember.
Yes, it was very nice.
Glad you remember the article, though I hardly dare expect you to remember the guy who wrote it.
You're looking for a Civic Theater story now?
Frankly, I don't know. I've been quite interested in some reports Ed Norman's been giving me about what's been happening at your church the last 3 or 4 weeks. I was especially interested when I heard that you...
Would you like to look around, Jim?
Yes, if you could spare 5 or 10 minutes. I said I've handled religious features for the paper, but...
You're probably the typical newspaperman. Strictly tongue-in-cheek when it comes to religion. I've been somewhat that way myself.
Religion is a precarious issue at times.
Mostly because we've made it that way.
Maybe you're right.
I guess I feel sorry for newspaper reporters. Just as I feel sorry for a lot of people. For anyone who, in order to be accepted with his crowd, thinks he has to insulate himself against the miraculous elements of the Christian faith.
It's amazing. A girl like you talking this way. You giving up acting?
Not necessarily.
I'm especially interested in what Mr. Norman has mentioned about your work out at the Eastside Area Mission. You know, with the kids down there.
They're wonderful kids.
You think the solution to a lot of our delinquency problems... You think religion...
I think the solution to the problem found at every level of society is to introduce, realistically, the living presence of Jesus Christ into every area of our lives.
I can't say I quite understand what you're talking about. So many things have been happening. Well, my boss, Ed Norman, for example.
You're out of your mind, Ed. Casually Sunday edition. That's a third of our advertising revenue.
I know, Clark. I have all the data here on my desk.
You're soft peddling politics. Going conservative in a town that likes a juicy story. That's bad enough. But it's editorial and I go along. But to cancel the Sunday paper. Why? All of a sudden it's a sin to publish a Sunday newspaper?
Clark? As a boy, I was raised in a community where people carefully observed Sunday as God's day. We didn't have time for Sunday newspapers or a lot of other things that go on these days. Publishing a Sunday paper in itself, of course, there's nothing wrong with that. But if in doing my part to honor the Lord's day, if by this very act we can somehow get through to the people of our community,
some more of those sermon editorials coming up, I suppose. Let me tell you something, Ed. Those high and holy front page editorials that you ran, with all that Bible quote, great for the knit and crochet crowd. But you've lost a lot of prestige around town. You know what's happened already to our circulation. So think sense on this Sunday edition. We ain't catering to the Pilgrims and the Puritans.
We're dropping the Sunday edition, Clark. We'll come out with a big Saturday paper instead.
Saturday? Let me tell you something. I don't know much about God. I don't know much about religion. But even if you get as pious as the angels, you'll never keep this paper solvent if you let a third of the advertising revenue go down the tubes. What's gotten into you, Ed? You were a good newspaper man till you got so hot-fired, worked up about religion all of a sudden.
Here we go again.
Shush! I had a friend of mine look at me across a martini yesterday and ask me how soon I figured on getting converted. That'll be the day.
It's time I clarified a few things with you people.
wanted to do this before, but even now, I'm not certain how to put into words what needs to be said. I'm reluctant, extremely reluctant, to impose upon any of you the... I'm fully aware, of course, that certain eventualities, motivated by my own personal convictions, may possibly affect all of you. I've been a religious man for many years, at least in the sense in which religion as such is quite popular in America today. But it's only in the past few weeks that I've come to know what it means to sense the presence of God in my life, to at last meet God on His terms, instead of always expecting Him to meet me on my terms. A man asked me the other day if I had appointed myself to sit in judgment over our community. True, we've changed the editorial policies of this paper rather drastically, but I sit in judgment of no one. Yet, as I remember my own past, and as I realize how far I am now from what God surely wants me to be, let me put it this way. The man who seems, according to most people's standards, not to need God, may well be the man who needs Him most. Self-righteousness, pride, confidence in one's material possessions, so typical of our town, of many communities. These have been the sins in my life. I'm available to discuss with any one of you how my new understanding of the Christian faith relates to the continuing operation of this newspaper.
I had a telephone call this afternoon. It was from the nicest young man.
That so?
It was really for you.
Jim Doan, the reporter? We were supposed to have lunch together, but I phoned him this morning.
It was Gregory Lenoir.
Oh.
What do you mean by that, oh? Without even an audition, just what he's heard about.